our first day's second session, Dr. Irtiza Hussain. He's a postdoc at Institute of Quantum Optics and Quantum Information, Austrian Academy of Sciences, Australia. He did his PhD in experimental quantum physics from Griffith University, Austria. Currently, he is involved in engineering a unique frequency comb based source to boost ultrafast UV pulse energy for generation approximately about 200 nanometer fast entangling gate between two laser cooled calcium atoms. And this is actually what he will also talk about today, if I'm not wrong. So over to Dr. Irtiza Hussain, please share your... Very good.
Okay, so should I start? Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to talk in this conference. Today, as you heard already, from Professor Sevi about single photons and doing some quantum mechanics experiment. So now I would like to tell you about how we can use single atoms instead of single photons to do this stuff. So actually what I'm focusing on is how we can develop tools for increasing entangling gate operations in calcium atomic ions. So I'm working in Austrian Academy of Sciences in Austria. Okay, let's start. This is our group photo. So we are over 50 people and working under Professor Blatt. And so the group research themes are related to basically mostly on quantum information, quantum computation stuff, quantum optics stuff, and quantum networking. So I myself involved in the Hussain experiments building aluminum clock and ultrafast, which I'm going to talk today on. So first, I'll give you a very quick introduction because time is short, and then I'll go for a theory and proposal and some experimental advances and what I've did so far and finding outlook. So just a brief introduction between the difference between classical and quantum information processing. So in classical world, we have a fixed binary logic in terms of 0 or 1, and you have heard already about these Boolean logic operations where you can operate AND, NOR, or whatever gates. But in quantum information processing, the main difference is we have a linear superposition of these two binary states, like you can see here. And we can describe in mathematically all these single and two qubit gates in terms of unity transformations. So these are simple linear poly matrices, and that's just representation for one of the two qubit gate, which is the control NOT gate. And you can see how a quantum logic circuit looks like. We prepare our quantum system in some initial state, and then we do a whole bunch of operations, and finally we do some measurements to see the outcome. Okay, so just to tell you briefly how we trap a single atom or single ion inside in a free space. So what we need is basically the six electrodes, where these two electrodes are defining the trap ground, and we are applying oscillating electric field, which is a radio frequency field, on the order of a few tens of megahertz to one of these two electrodes. And these two electrodes are basically defining some, basically they place a DC potential. So to make this picture more clear, what it looks like is something like this. Here you can see in the end view. So basically when you apply this RF potential, so we are swapping these two polarities. As a result, atom doesn't know where to go actually. It gets trapped inside this potential, okay? But I can do this in the RF frequency with my hands. You can see here, that's maybe a more clear picture, for example. Here you can see this animation. So basically that's how it looks like when you apply oscillating electric field with two electrodes on the ground. And this defines your trap frequency when ion oscillates inside this trap when we apply this obvious trap potential. Okay. So that's how this is. This is just a cartoon. You can see a whole bunch of lasers when we trap an ion inside the trap. Here you can see these blade electrodes, because there are different ways to make it done. So here, just for example, how we are doing it, we're using blade electrodes and these end caps, and this whole bunch of lasers are used to cool down the ion to basically to manipulate the quantum states And as a result of cooling, we can actually harness the quantumness which lies inside a single atom or ion. And we can, by building an imaging system, we can image the ion outside the trap. Okay. So here you can see a few pictures of the ions, which is the calcium ion. Okay, so that's how a trap looks like from outside. And just to let you know, in ion trapping, how we can encode qubits. There are two ways and two possible ways. The first way is by encoding qubits in the internal states that are just the electronic states of the ion, like for example, the metal stable state and the ground state. And other way is to do in the hyperfine states, which is the ground states in the defining with the hyperfine states of the ion. So for different species, we can do with this thing. For example, in here we have calcium, strontium, ytterbium, and for hyperfine qubits, we can do with beryllium, magnesium, and so many others. Okay, so gates and the state measurement. So here just an example. For example, this is my ground state, which is depicting the qubit state up or down. This is my exciting state, which is depicting the metal stable state with the lifetime of about 1.1 second. And we apply some particular laser. So you can see here the lifetime for 1.1 second. Essentially, it's a clock transition. So we have to use a very narrow line with laser to actually to drive this transition. So it's 79 is about few hertz broad, the line width of this laser, which is a bit hard. But essentially, what you're doing is when we control the timing of this laser pulse, we can create superposition between these two qubit states. And when you want to see in which state the other qubit lies, so we shine another laser between S half and P half state. That's just a reduced energy level diagram of this calcium ion. So I'm ignoring all the other states. So as long as the ion is in the state, if it is prepared in the state S half, so this blue transition gonna evolve or basically produce some fluorescence, and we can detect that fluorescence on the camera. So here you can see the image we see on the camera of a single ion, which means the ion is prepared in the S half state. But if it's in the metastable state, then we won't gonna see anything. So there will be nothing, just a dark. Okay, that's how we just quickly see the state measurements. So as I told you, the ion oscillates inside the trap, and it has some internal levels. So and we have used lasers to cool it down. For example, the first step is to do use the Doppler cooling. So as a result of that, we can reach to, for example, roughly to few microkelvin temperature. As a result, we can see we can actually exploit the motional states of the ion, and we have to couple these motional states with the internal state that is basically intrinsically coupled inside the trap. And by coupling these 2 degrees of freedom, we can make a lot of different gates and different protocols to do the information processing, and that's basically one of the key thing in the trap and quantum computation. So here you can see a quantum register of 7 ions, which have been in different modes inside that trap. They are freely hanging into that trap, so you can see a center of mass mode and the stretch modes for the 7 ions. So essentially, we are coupling an internal and the motional states of the ion. So what you're seeing here is the fluorescence from each ion, which is you can see all the 7 dots on this screen. So there are different ways to do this, realized quantum computation information processing, but to my best of knowledge, trapped ion is one of the promising ways to basically do this thing. Beside all these different and good qualities of this particular candidate, the one problem here is the entangling gate operations are relatively slow as compared to others. So we want to expedite this entangling gate operation, and there was a proposed by Ignacio Serac and Peter Zoller, Garcia Ripoll in 2003, and since then it has not been implemented so far until now. So and the difficulty lies in basically in engineering the particular optical source which can actually do this trick. So the idea is following. So here you can see a dashed lines which is depicting us the oscillatory or basically the harmonic movement of an ion inside the harmonic potential inside that trap, and when there is no external perturbations. But if we apply state-dependent forces or just call a force on the ion, so essentially in this phase-based picture, basically in the momentum and the position, you can see we apply some force, the ion gets some kick, in this in the momentum coordinates, and then it oscillates again in this in this free motion movement. Then you apply again kick, there is some free movement, then you kick back, and then again some free movement, kick again. So coming back to the point where we started. So as a result of this cyclic movement, basically we evolve as something so-called a belly phase that helps us to entangle two qubit states of the two ions. Okay, so that's the idea, rough idea. So the key point here is we have to produce state-dependent forces, and that forces should be very, very fast. Very, very, very fast kicks and forces, basically, okay? And we have to take care of the timing of these forces, when those forces are gonna be evolved on the ion, basically, okay? So what we need is basically essentially a laser, a pulse laser that is fast enough that can do this trick. So the requirements is this. So here you can see our system, the calcium ion. So what we are doing here is, so these are basically, as I told you before, there's a qubit levels, so basically with tried by 7 to 9 transition, and 397 is our Doppler coding line, and 393 is the transition where we want our kicking force or kicking light force to be implemented, okay? Do we want a pulse laser? Because the point here is it's a dipole transition with a strong transition. We can easily address this transition. We don't need to be very, very, and since the pulse laser, we have to be very, very careful because the pulse lasers have a very broad spectrum. So this is a tricky thing. So essentially what we need to do is basically want to have a pulse repetition rate that is much, much faster than the trap period, the ion which is oscillating inside the trap. It should be much faster than that, and also the pulses should be resonant with this line where you want to address, basically this 393 nanometer transition, okay? And it should have a low pulse length. The pulse width itself should be much smaller than the excited state lifetime of this P3 half transition, otherwise it's going to get back to into the state one, and then it's going to ruin all the experiment. And we need basically a few pulses. A pi pulse means it can coherently transfer the population from state 1 to state 2, and when a second pulse arrives, it basically reverses the same process. It depopulates from population from state 2 back to the state 1. So that's the idea. Okay, so we're doing it, basically we want to apply basically a counter propagating pi pulses on the ion. So this blue dot is basically just depicting an ion. As a result, we're going to implement a force on the ion while stimulating the emission because the repetition rate is very fast, and this force scales with the repetition rate. Okay, so with a high repetition rate, high enough pulse energy, we can do this trick. But such sources are not available in the industry so far. It's very difficult to engineer such things because you want to have a narrow bandwidth and very, very fast repetition rate and few other requirements. So that's what we have achieved last year. So we have a single pulse excitation probability up to 96.4%. And at that time, we had a pulse energy of about 80 picojoule. Okay. But to do as you have seen already, we want to implement this in a counter-propagating fashion to basically further increase the speed. And to do this, we have to split a single pulse into two and then come back on the ion in a counter-propagating fashion. So as a result, what we need is definitely we need at least 200 picojoule of pulse energy. And each pulse should be capable of doing a pi transition, like coherent population transfer, which means 100% population transfer from ground to excited, then excited back to the ground. Okay. So we are doing with this by using a frequency comb. That's just a basic principle for those who have no much background on this. So basically, frequency comb is essentially a pulse laser, which is producing femtosecond pulses, and the main thing here is we are locking the repetition rate and the carrier envelope offset due to it happens due to cavity birefringence and some other nonlinear processes. So here you can see your pulse envelope in time space, and this is So here you can see this pulse envelope in time space, and you can see when impulse propagates, there is some phase difference with respect to this envelope. So that is defining here in terms of this frequency offset. So we basically lock this frequency offset, and we lock the repetition rate, then essentially this entire the basically the spectrum of the pulses looks like a very, very fine spacing of the different modes of the frequency, which are inside basically the pulses that are hidden. So we can see in the frequency domain, so essentially it acts like a frequency ruler, and you can use this to do a lot of tricks in the optical box and so many experiments, and that's what multivariate is, a drive the atomic transition. Okay. So that's how your physically your basically seed oscillator looks like. It's a comb, which is a linear fiber cavity design. So what we're doing is there's our EDF, which is erbium dot fiber laser, which is a gain medium for this laser. Okay, and here you have a PMM, that is a piezo mounted mirror. That's not actually we have, but that's how it normally looks like. Okay, just for your big thought. And then we have a CSEM here, which is a semiconductor saturable absorber mirror, which triggers mode locking. Most of you, I guess, know about this thing, which is a nonlinear process, intensity dependent nonlinear process to trigger the mode locking. And as a result, what we are getting out of here is about this is WDM, is a wavelength deviant multiplexer to pump, to gain a pump from the external diode into this system. And so as a result, we are getting about 75 femtosecond pulses out of the seed oscillator. And here you can look at the bandwidth, the spectrum bandwidth of the pulses, about 45 nanometers. So the next step what we do is we amplify the pulses and then we stretch them, so-called chipping, and then we pass it through the spectral filter. Basically what we're doing is, like you have seen in the previous in the slide, we have a bandwidth about 45 nanometers. But here by spectral slicing, we are getting the right spectrum, right peak, where you want to then resonate with atomic transition after this. And I will tell you in a moment that why we are selecting this particular transition out of this entire range of this spectrum. So after getting spectral slicing, we are sitting somewhere here at 1572 nanometers. And later what we do is we amplify with erbium dot fiber amplifier, and we have some filter cavities. So these filter cavities have a basically a free spectral range of 5 gigahertz. So essentially what ends up happening is when pulses passes through, and sorry, maybe I forgot to tell you, we have about repetition about 250 megahertz here inside the comb. And when these 250 megahertz pulses passes through the filter cavity 1, we end up having a repetition rate of 5 gigahertz. So there are some locking mechanism and things which I have not shown you at the moment. But again, we have the same filter cavity to make sure we have a coarse filtering. And again, we have some amplification with the post-optic amplifier. Okay? Because this all process is quite lossy. So what ends up happening here, after this point, we have a 5 gigahertz telecom band pulses coming out of this BOA. Okay. So the next step, what we're doing is we're adding some additional chirping. So there is a problem, we can't add the entire chip in the stretched fiber because our pulse period is very, very short. It's 200 picosecond. I mean, the repetition rate is very high. Okay, so if we add the entire chip here in the stretched fiber, then we're gonna overlap the wings of each pulse into each other, and we're gonna forfeit the ability to actually discriminate between the different pulses. So that makes it just pretty tricky. So we decided to have two different stages of adding chirping inside the data system. So we're adding additional chirp here, some additional filters here, and then again we're amplifying with every time bubble amplifier. We have the circulator, which basically pushes the light toward this chirp fiber bragg grating. From this fiber bragg grating, light reflects back into circulator and comes down into the system. And we roughly estimated about, we need about 1 kilometer of SMF28 fiber to do this experiment. But we have, since we have split the chipping stages, so it's still looking fine. So then after all this amplification, we're sending pulse, is basically the standard way to do the amplification to avoid non-linear effects. First we chip the pulses and then we're amplifying to the high power levels. So we're using 10 watt average power erbium on fiber amplifier. And just to maximize the peak intensities, what we need is we want at the end is we have want to have, as I told you, because we have chipped the pulses already, and we want to de-chip them back, because if we can't do this, then we cannot get maximum peak intensity there, which we will need in the later stages. Okay, so what we do is we use chip volume bragg grating, which again reflects light back after receiving, and by this half wave plate and quarter wave plate control, we reflect light back from this poor as an splitter. And then at this point, we are having about 575 femtosecond compressed pulses with an average power of more than 9 watt. Okay, a telecom band. So in the next step here, you can see the frequency resolved optical gating. It's a technique to measure the pulse characteristics. So you can see here we have the pulse duration of about 576 femtosecond out of the compressor, which I just told you a moment ago. Next step is the frequency of conversion. So to resonate with atomic transition, we have to upconvert the frequency, because we at the moment, yeah, all you can see we are doing all this stuff in telecom band. Okay, this is 1572 nanometer line. But what we need is 393 line, this particular line. So we have to upconvert this light carefully to resonate this atomic transition. So we do this by using this nonlinear technique, the standard technique, basically using a particularly cold lithium niobate crystal. As a result, we upconvert the frequency from 1572 to 786 nanometer, and then we have the single pass conversion efficiency about 50% here. And here you can see quickly how this frequency of conversion scaling looks like with the input and the power versus the output. Okay. So in the next step, we use
the time is almost over here. Just last minute, please.
Okay, so then we use another crystal to do this stuff. And then we have, since I told you, we need few pulses. So we're using, we're producing billions of pulses, 1 billion pulses per second. So to get only few pulses out of the laser, we have to use some switching techniques. So by using these techniques, we can switch the pulses. Basically, we can extract only few pulses out of this pulse train. Here you can see the picture. We can getting about nine pulses out of this entire pulse train. And then we just shoot, just send this pulse to the trap. And the next thing is we are exploiting the long time constant of an amplifier to basically retain high pulse energy and high repetition rate in the payload pulses. Okay. But at the end, what we are getting is about 800 picojoule pulse energy at 5 gigahertz repetition rate, which is resonant with the atomic transition. I guess should I should stop here to get more questions there, but that's how labs look like. And you're welcome to read these papers. But how we actually use this quantum machine to do some real time, so some real experiments on this quantum computers. So you're welcome to read these papers and feel free to ask me questions. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Irtiza, for such a nice talk. I'm really very happy to hear this wonderful talk from you, because you is one of my students of classical mechanics.
And yeah. So I forgot to mention this in the start.
So let's go to the questions. There are some questions. The first question from Arslan Sajid Raja. So could you switch on your mic?
Yeah, I can't hear anything.
Let me see. Arslan Sajid Raja. So from attendee, yeah, now you can switch on your mic, please.
So I think you mentioned a lot of stuff about frequency comb. So I see that you presented a very complex architecture, you know, go from telecom to visible using up conversion. So it's a really, the conversion efficiency is not high. So what is like, if you just use very narrow line lasers, I mean, where you need your transition around 730 nanometer, 400 nanometer. I understand, like, you cannot make laser around 400 nanometer. So what kind of, like, a complexity are there, you know, in terms of just using a laser and the frequency comb?
Yeah, I got your point. The main thing is that basically, as I told you in the motivation slide, we need very fast repetition rate pulses with high average power to get this pipe transition done, okay? So with this, if you're talking about the CW lasers, that can't do it. Because to best of my knowledge, I don't know any switch that can create a 5 gigahertz pulse train that is resonant to the atomic transition.
Okay.
It's quite difficult. Yeah.
Can I ask one more question?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so because I work with Kircon, so you might have heard about this thing. So I work with Tobias Kippenberg at EPFL. So the thing is, like, the good thing about microcomb is there, you know, you can really change your, depending on the material you use, you can go to visible or to UV, or not to UV, but at least to visible range. So do you see any application of microcomb there in terms of, like, maybe of like optical clocks or the work you are doing there, you know?
In optical clocks, yes, we can see, but it again, it depends either which clock element we are using. Because for aluminum, at least where we are working on, for us, I mean, this optical domain is fine, like this visible range or so-called, you know, telecom and all this range is fine for us. But for microcomb stuff, you're talking about particularly for my own, for this particular experiment which I just spoke a moment ago, I think as long as you can, if there's a way, please, I'll be happy to know. I mean, as long as we can match this atomic transition frequency wisely enough that we are not disturbing other levels, then yes, it can do a trick.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I mean, we can discuss offline, you know, there's a nice thing.
You are more than welcome.
Yeah, okay, great.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. So, any other question? So, if we do not have any more questions, so thank you very much, Irtiza, once again. So now it's for the last talk. Let's proceed. Could you please stop sharing?
Yeah.
Yeah. Good.